Thanks, little guy.
Ding-ding.
Oh, thank you.
Ding-ding.
Did I miss something? When did we get to Disneyland?
I've seen hubris before, but I've never seen hubris like this. Rian Johnson trying to compare what he did to Snoke to the Emperor is just fucking stupid. All right, good morning. Round two of the videos today, because there's a lot of stuff going on that I want to cover. So welcome back to the Cantina. All right, I am your chaos coordinator, Wookiee Wrangler, bar manager, Stephanie Janicek, here to fill you in on the facts. So yesterday, MovieWeb.com had an interview with the infamous Rian Johnson, who basically is trying to propagandize that somehow The Empire Strikes Back was not received well back in 1980. What? What? Yeah, he said that. He said, you know, basically intimating that, you know, in 20 years people will love The Last Jedi like they love The Empire Strikes Back, which is, I mean, he's basically, this is the hubris this guy has. Let me explain something about hubris. Hubris is aspirations to the gods. It's a Greek word. That's what it means, literally. And Rian Johnson is an ego-filled narcissist with the hubris that I can't even contemplate having that much self. Oh, God. Self-centeredness and self-aggrandizement. Self-awareness. It boggles the mind, okay? To say that and then to put that ignorance out there, because it is ignorant, and say young kids like last night, I woke up and some girl was saying something about The Empire Strikes Back, and I'm like, that's the most ignorant statement I've ever seen. But then I realized, who said it? Who started this shit? The idiot who made this movie. All right, let's talk a little bit about Empire. First off, you had writers Lee Brackett before she passed away, and Larry Kasdan. Larry Kasdan was on top of his game. You had producers like Gary Kurtz there. You had Irvin Kershner directing, George Lucas producing, and his overall vision, okay? And you had, I think, one of the greatest casts of all time assembled again to make the next movie. See, when you're doing a trilogy like this, the middle movie should always be the darkest one. Now, George Lucas has always thought that. If you look at the Indiana Jones trilogy, before they added Crystal Skull to it, Temple of Doom was a very dark movie. In fact, it's the first movie that was rated PG-13. All right, that rating, literally, it was inspired by Temple of Doom. Very dark movie. Same thing with The Empire Strikes Back. Just because the Rebels blew up the Death Star doesn't mean they could all right off into the sunset victorious. You have to remember just how big the damn Empire was and just how big the galaxy was, all right? And that Vader would be found and brought back. All right, so they're on the run. They swatted, they took a good swat and, you know, hurt the Empire. The Empire now wants a little bit of vengeance. So they're on the run. And everything bad happens, all right? Luke gets caught out in the cold. He's attacked by a Wampa. Han has to go rescue him. Putting his life in danger, too, to find his friend. And then the Empire appears on in Hoth's space. and basically all hell breaks loose. The Battle of Hoth was probably one of the greatest battle sequences, I think, filmed for a sci-fi movie ever. Very well written. Everything in that movie, let's put it, was very tight. The dialogue was tight. The cast knew what they were doing. You could just see it. It was going to come together and be something really special. Now, people walking out, I was bawling. I was crying my eyes out. But people didn't walk out like they did when they walked out of The Last Jedi, or murmuring, God, what a piece of shit that was, you know, to each other. They were like, how are they going to get Han back? Will Luke become a Jedi? What's going to happen? You know, will Vader confront him again? You know, these were all the things. I don't see anybody saying that about this. And there's a reason why that movie is considered the top of all Star Wars. It is quite possibly, and I've said this before, the tightest script ever written for a Star Wars movie. Irvin Kershner knew exactly what he was doing. Now him and Lucas kind of cracked heads together. And, you know, after Empire Strikes Back, Gary Kurtz quit, which is too bad because Kurtz, I think, is probably the greatest, one of the greatest connections Lucas could have for Star Wars. But, you know, this is neither here nor there. The idea that Rian Johnson, who, if anything, will only ever be known as an infamous person in Star Wars canon and Star Wars lore, could actually think this thing was as good as The Empire Strikes Back, boggles the mind. I mean, first off, The Empire Strikes Back, again, you don't need a novel and you don't need a film degree to understand what's going on, okay? All I gotta do is sit and watch it. The writers were that good. The director was that good. The vision was that good, okay? Where the novels for the movies only enhanced what you were watching, not explained what you were watching, okay? It was a real respect for what they were doing. A real passion for what they were doing too, because they actually cared about the story. You care, you know, them like the audience and like the actors, the filmmakers cared about the characters, okay? They cared about presenting them in a certain way. This thing, it was literally the most disrespectful thing I've ever seen in my life. And the fact that Rian Johnson actually has the cojones, little tiny walnut-sized ones, to say what he said in Movie Web is staggering to me. Again, it's hubris. You know, and I want to leave you guys with this. Rian, you are not George Lucas, okay? You are not Irvin Kershner. You are not Steven Spielberg. You are not Ridley Scott. You couldn't carry their clipboards, okay? You have no vision. Everything you made in The Last Jedi was for you and no one else. When you told anybody who'd listen, you're making a story, a movie for them, for you and not for anybody else, not for the fans, you might as well have walked off the set, because suddenly Star Wars ceased to exist and Rian Johnson's ego came in. This great big giant ego, all right? If you were making your own movie like Knives Out, okay, fine, I don't give a shit. I'm not gonna see it anyway because it looks boring to me, all right? However, you weren't making Knives Out. You weren't making a Rian Johnson solely produced movie. You were making a Star Wars Skywalker saga movie, which should have said, careful where you tread, careful how you present this, and remember to respect the canon, the lore, the characters, and the fans. None of what you did. Why? Because that ginormous ego and your hubris, which could fill up a football stadium. So, this is the thing, and Star Wars fans are all going to have to live with this for a long, long time, okay? There's going to be little kids, you know, let's see, stunted adolescence, because the people who like this, the Jason Wards, the Steel Saunders, the Hello Greedos, and the rest of these foul excuses of human beings, will be there and not shutting up. But I do have to admit, JJ, it looks like, is trying to fix what was broken. He's basically said it was a course correction, and he said that a year ago, more than a year ago, when you've got Lucas himself, kind of the guiding hand here. You know, hopefully we can put The Last Jedi with an asterisk, like a great big zit that popped. Okay, that's the only comparison I can give it. You know, instead of actually, what I hate about it, and this is what I'm going to leave you with, what I hate about The Last Jedi, no questions were answered, more plot holes were created, introducing things like Han's lucky gold dice. Why? I mean, you know, Chewie bumped his head in him in A New Hope, and suddenly they're a thing. You know, Luke not really having a reason to be where he is. We have to now wait. You know, what? You know, the fact that we have to argue with Raylos, whom Rian Johnson encourages by trolling them. We have to argue about who Rey still is. You know, I don't want to do that. There are questions that needed to be answered so we can start asking other questions. You know, in The Empire Strikes Back, the Emperor was like a ghostly amorphous form. He was a hologram. Then in Return of the Jedi, he was a fully formed villain. You saw the tweet that Johnson put out there. There is no explanation for the villain, so I could do that with Snoke. Actually, there was an explanation for Palpatine. Okay? We knew he was the bad guy. We knew in a way how he got to be where he got. Okay, and George Lucas then, after 20 years, filled in the rest of it. Okay, we didn't need to really have that explained when we kind of figured it out on our own, because the story was so good. Because the story told us, all right? We knew he was a dark side user. We knew he was a Sith Lord. We knew he must have fallen, all right? We knew he was the master of Darth Vader. All right. So Rian Johnson saying what he said about us not really, about, you know, the Emperor really not having a reason is, again, hubris filled stupidity on steroids. Okay. Killed off Snoke just to kill him off, because your Snoke theory sucks, according to Steel Saunders. And the stickers that he made sure Pablo and Rian got, you know, mocking the fans. Again, not the way you go about garnering customers and making them happy, all right? Because instead of filet mignon, like we got, was Empire Strikes Back, we got McDonald's, you know, green and pink sludge. But hey, remember, it's our fault we didn't like it, and it's our fault we didn't, you know, want to go back to it again and again and again and again, right? It's our fault. It was so good, and we just didn't understand. Because in this day and age, and I will leave you with this, people like Rian Johnson will fuck something up. Instead of saying, I fucked up, I'm sorry, what can I do to fix it? Or saying, I made a mistake, I was wrong, I'm not going to make any more Star Wars movies, and being humble, they blame the people who didn't like what they did, and it's our fault, which is the height of immaturity, arrogance, and it's typical millennial 2019 attitude by weak people, all right? And it's perpetuated by shill sites, by the mainstream shills, Lycanpia, etc. All right? Because remember, it's always your fault. It's never the person who did its fault. Kind of like Raylo's blaming Han and Leia for the way Darth Emo turned out. Okay? Nothing is his fault. It's a 30-year-old he-baby. Right, Ryan? And on that note, everybody on the planet knows you're just egging these people on. You're just a great big giant troll anymore. And until Bob Iger comes out and says, you have a trilogy, I don't believe you. Why aren't you home writing it then? All right? The idea that you could actually compare this piece of garbage to Empire is ludicrous. It's absolutely, it is disrespectful to George Lucas. It's disrespectful to Star Wars. It's plain, typical, spoiled brat characterization, which you are. Ryan, you're a cartoon. You are a cartoon. This is Steph signing out. See you around the galaxy. See you around the cantina. Please remember, tip the Wookiee bartenders 20%. No droids, no bounty hunters, no Raylos, no Ray nobodies, no Ray Luke's clone hand, no Ray Luke, or clone of Leia, no Ray reincarnated Anakin, no Ray Immaculate Conception, none of that shit. No Ray Kenobis. No Ray Yoda's daughter. Alright? This is Steph. No fights in the cantina. You take this stuff out in the alley. Gunfights, you take this shit on the street. See you around the galaxy.